Ah. We're going to start in just a minute. We're just waiting for Dr. Parker to arrive. Could the people in the back, Mike Hartley, you guys, can you just move closer to the front? Because I'm going to be walking around with a microphone, and I'm too lazy to walk all that way. I'm tired from having done the dancing in the opening session this morning, and I don't want to walk that far. So everybody just move a little bit closer to the front, and we'll get going. I'm just going to wait a few minutes just to see if Dr. Parker arrives, as I'm sure he will. And we'll get water for our valued panelists. Okay, everybody, welcome, and now that all of our panelists have arrived, we'll get started. Those of you at the back, just come closer to the front if you don't mind, just because I have to walk around with the microphone to get people to talk, so you don't have to stand up. This is like the opposite of this morning's opening session. Instead of dancing, we're just going to sit and try not to move at all. The highlight of that for me, were you there, Dr. Parker? This morning at the opening session, were you there? The highlight for me was watching John Flores surfing. That was the highlight. We all danced. I should have taken video, but they had instructed us to put our phones down first, unfortunately. So this is, I think, maybe the third year now that there's been this EQ session, or maybe it's more. I'm not sure. This is my second year doing it. EQ stands for emotional quotient, and it's kind of the touchy-feely, hippy-dippy IQ for people that are in touch with their feelings. But it's a very different flavor of session that we traditionally have in CCS. And CCS, when I was first started coming to CCS, which was like 18 years ago or something like that, this type of session would have been kind of sneered at, and, oh, why are we talking about things that aren't just cardiology? Who cares whether you're burnt out or you have a life outside of medicine? So I think increasingly we're realizing that as a cardiologist, you're also a whole person, and things that happen outside of work affect you. There's transition times that are sometimes stressful to you, whether it's transitioning into your career or transitioning out. We all have multiple things to balance, and time management and burnout are real issues. So that's what this session is about. And we have an hour and a half, but I'm not sure we're going to need that much time. We do have some audience participation questions. So everybody get out their phones, and if you can get onto the CCS app Then, so if you have the app, just go to open the app and then click on the audience response system icon, which you'll see along the bottom. Or you can type ccc2019.cnf.io into your browser. Address bar, you can click and tap on this session, which is EQ in cardiac sciences. And then when there's questions that come up, you'll be asked to answer. So I wanted to thank the panel for coming. I'm not sure who picked the panel members and me. It wasn't me. I just got, will you do it again this year? And I'm like, sure. So panel members, I'm not the one who selected you. If you want to blame someone, it's somebody else on the planning committee. That's not me. But I want to thank everybody for coming. And I've got some intros of people that are kind of just beyond the usual stuff. I'll introduce myself first. So I'm Dr. Sarah Raymer. I don't have to refer to the slide to see who I am, but that's me, Sarah Raymer. I'm an associate professor at Dalhousie. I did a fellowship in echocardiography at Mount Sinai back in the day. My main sort of role in my division has been education. So I was program director for adult cardiology for 7 years, finishing up in June of this year. I'm the chair of the TRP, the trainee review program for adult cardiology exam prep. And I've been involved in a number of things. I was a CSE board member, and I'm on some guidelines committees with the CSE and such. But you know, the next slide is like who we really are in real life. So I did a minor in music, and I'm a professional cellist. I've played with the Kingston Symphony. I played with University of New Brunswick, the New Brunswick Symphony Orchestra, and I've played with the PEI Symphony Orchestra. I have a concert with them coming up next month. Son up on the top right, he's 3. He's playing with my Hewlett-Packard Rappaport Sprague stethoscope, because that's the way we roll in my family. No Fisher Price for you. I'll give you my discontinued $1,000 stethoscope to play with instead. My husband, Dan, is he's 48. He's a retired Navy officer. And our lives changed when I was pregnant with our first. Maddie, you can see, practicing to howl with her dad. She's 5 now. When we were pregnant with her, my husband was diagnosed with lung cancer at the age of 43, never smoked in his life. And so that changed our lives greatly. He was a Navy officer, and we didn't really want him out deploying even once he was recovered from the cancer. So we retired him, and we took on a second job. So I'm already ready for my retirement, because Dan and I are national marketing directors of an anti-aging company affiliated with Princeton. So I'm all ready to retire now. Maybe. Dr. Chris Fordyce is the next person on our panel. He's right there in the middle. I went alphabetically. I didn't know what order you guys would be sitting in. So he's the director of the cardiac ICU at Vancouver General Hospital. He's been on staff there since 2016. So he's our early career person. He did a research fellowship at Duke Clinical Research Institute. He did fellowship training in critical care at Duke. And he's got a lot of things in his bio. I didn't include everything, but highlights are chair of the AHA Scientific Statement on Preventing Complications in the Cardiac ICU, member of the primary panel for the 2019 CCS STEMI guidelines, and a bunch of other things. But Chris sent me this slide, which again represents Chris, the whole person, and not just Chris, the cardiologist. So he's happily married to an extremely supportive spouse who's a chartered accountant / MBA, and you said she could have gone to medical school. Thankfully for you, she didn't. Being married to a doctor, I gather, is no fun, according to my husband. She still laughs at his dumb jokes, which is great. He has 3 children, aged 9, 6, and 2, and a North Carolina rescue dog, who's super cute. You can see him there in the top right. He likes skiing, although he says he has a high happiness to skill ratio, like cycling. He caught a 23-pound Chinook salmon, which seems very heavy. Coaches t-ball and soccer, likes jogging with or without the dog, and also likes to travel. Anything you'd like to add to that, Chris?
No,
that pretty much sums up your life?
That's my life.
Okay, good. Next, alphabetically, we have Dr. Kathy Kells, who shouldn't be a stranger to anybody in this room. She's a professor at Dalhousie. She did interventional cardiology. She's an interventional cardiologist still. She did a fellowship also in adult congenital heart disease at Stanford. She was my program director when I did adult cardiology back in the day, so she spent many years as program director. She was the division head of our division, and she's also the past president of the Canadian Cardiovascular Society. So she's done just about every leadership role that one can do. But again, here's Kathy in real life. So in the top left, there's Kathy's most recent shot. And immediately to her right there is one of her and her husband, Dave Kells. And Dave is a financial advisor, really nice guy. Down below that picture is a picture of Kathy and her father. No, I'm kidding. That's Eugene Braunwald. That's not her dad. That's Kathy at the ESD this year, moderating with Eugene Bronwald. Kathy's three kids are on the bottom left there, Katie, Megan, and Patrick. And on the bottom right, I gather that was a retro ski day, and that's not your everyday ski outfit. You didn't tell me that when you sent me that picture, and I thought, oh my God, her style is a little bit off. So I was glad to see that. Kathy also tells me that she's a passionate skier, traveler, and a really average folk guitar player. I don't know, you seem to be playing the air guitar pretty well in that session this morning. Sue Morris is our next person alphabetically. There's Sue, second to my right there. So Sue has been a nurse for 3.5 decades, which is awfully long time. She graduated from the St. John's School of Nursing in 1984. She's done a number of things, including a Master's of Education, a Master's of Nursing. She has the Canadian Nurses Association Certificate in Critical Care and Cardiovascular Care. She's been in her 3.5 decades a frontline cardiac nurse, a CVICU charge nurse, a nurse manager, which she said was very brief. Managing not your thing? Yeah, okay. As a clinical nurse educator, she's been had many leadership hats, including provincial director of Canadian Council for Cardiovascular Nurses, and moved on to be the president of the Canadian Council for Cardiovascular Nurses, and she's also the track captain for the nursing track in CCC. But in her real life, outside of medicine, she's been married for 34 years to what she calls her favorite boy, Patrick, her husband. Her favorite pastime is vacation planning, favorite destination is Mexico, and favorite activity is swimming. She has two daughters who both became nurses. Excellent. And she's got three grandchildren that bring a new level of pleasure into her life. We have on the bottom right there, Ada, age 2, and the newborn twins in the top left, Luke and Callie, born on September 25th, 2019, so not even a month old. Wow, that's exciting. Her hobbies include photography and painting, and some examples of her work here. Did I miss anything, Sue? Perfect. Next, we have John Parker. So John is from Kingston. He trained at Queen's and then went to Boston for Brigham and Women's for further training. He's been a professor of medicine and pharmacology at U of T on faculty since 1992. He's a clinician scientist and invasive cardiologist at Mount Sinai and the UHN. He's the former division head of cardiology. That's supposed to say UHN. I don't know how that N got in there. Now, John didn't get the memo that I wanted to have personal pictures. So these are the only two pictures I could find of John on the internet. One seems to have been taken about 20 years before the other one. Yeah, at least 20 years. John is, again, from Kingston. When he went to Boston for 5 years of further training, he said he learned little cardiology, but did come to the understanding that most of the world is smarter than I am, according to the quote. In 1992, he returned. He established a program in clinical research and clinical pharmacology and physiology. In terms of personal interests, he says, funding the never-ending education of his two children, Larissa and Jennifer, and an ongoing amazement of the indefatigable support of his wife, Andrea. He enjoys skiing, biking, gardening, travel, and maintaining personal sanity in the face of 27 years of Toronto traffic, which I can relate to, having done a fellowship there. Okay, so last but not least, we have Dr. Chris Simpson. And Chris is a professor at Queen's University. He's an electrophysiologist, former head of cardiology at Queen's, former CMA president. We saw his picture on the slide that Dr. Osler, who's joined us, showed this morning. You know, part of the diversity problem, I guess. He's not even listening to me. That's okay. First president of the Canadian Society of Heart Rhythm. He's the vice dean, clinical and medical director of CMO in Queen's School of Medicine. What does CMO stand for?
It's our alternate practice plan.
The alternate practice plan. Okay, that doesn't sound fun. Okay. Here's a few snippets on Chris. He has a Wikipedia entry. That happens when you've been CMA president, or do you just put that in yourself? I don't know. The Wikipedia thing just happens once you reach a certain level of fame. He was born in Nakawik, New Brunswick, home of the world's largest axe. He's got four kids and three stepkids. That's seven, if anyone's good at counting. That's a lot of kids to put through university. He's a swim dad. He lives on an island accessible only by ferry, and he enjoys the moments of solitude that imparts. He describes himself as a lapsed musician. He said he played the piano and played the saxophone in a big swing band. He provided me with a picture on the bottom left of him playing saxophone at the Royal York in 1998. Was that for John Harris? What was the event?
That was for Harrison McCain's birthday
Harrison McCain's birthday party. Oh, that's exciting. There's a picture I found on Twitter of Chris with one of his daughters. And the one on the bottom right, I just found that on like a newspaper article. And I thought, that is the worst picture ever. I'm going to throw that in just to, you know, just to show that I don't just select the nicest pictures of people for their presentations. So that's who we are. And now a question for the audience. Tell us about you. So here's the question for you guys. My options aren't showing up. Oh, that's less than ideal. One is you're a trainee. Is there a way to see what my options are? Okay, here we are. Yeah, just throw them and then you can throw them in. So trainee, adult cardiologist, peds. So one will be for trainee, two for adult cardiologist, three for peds cardiologist, four for cardiac surgeon, five for nurse, and six for other. Yeah, I guess I needed to have the options on there to have the questions answered before we move to the answers, so. Okay, great. So we have lots of nurses here today, a few trainees, and some cardiologists. And everybody, there are going to be some more questions. So everybody log into the app just to have that ready as we go through. Sue's drummed up quite a crowd here today. Okay, so we're going to talk about career transitions, then we're going to talk about burnout and time management, and some of these things might be sort of intertwangled, to create a new word, so we may sort of hop back and forth, and this is meant to be interactive, so I'm going to ask the panel some questions. They're going to give us just there's really been no preparation for this in terms of nobody's got a script or anything. We're just going to have discussions about these things, and then if anybody has things to add, just shout and I'll bring the microphone over to you, but it's really meant to be an interactive discussion. So first we're going to talk about early career transition, and we've got Dr. Fordyce as our most recently has been through an early career transition person on the panel, so we'll be talking to him about that. And then in terms of retirement, we'll be talking to Dr. Parker. These are some trainees of mine who graduated a few years ago. They've all transitioned into their early careers. We've got on the extreme left a heart failure transplant specialist, a community cardiologist in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, critical care trained cardiologist in Kelowna, and a community cardiologist in Sydney. Transitioning to your career is something that can cause some stress, and it's something that we don't get a whole lot of training on. I suppose that may change with the change to competency by design curriculum, where the last 6 months of training are meant to be transitioned to practice, but nonetheless, it can be a time of some hardship. So Chris, why don't you just start us off by telling us about your own experience with transitioning from fellowship to career and what challenges you faced?
Okay. Well, thanks for the opportunity to come today, and I'm not sure if I have any pearls of wisdom, but I can certainly share what happened with me. I think so I trained at UBC, internal medicine and cardiology, and you know, it's and I see it now with our fellows. There is maybe in your first start, definitely your second and your third year, but definitely your second year of cardiology training of a three-year program, I think people start thinking about jobs, and there's a huge focus on jobs. I think where do I want to live? Where do I what's available to me? Academic, community. So I think for me, the transition started, like many others, you know, during fellowship. It sort of feels like a three-year interview, the entire fellowship process, to be honest. I think what helped me was I surrounded myself for people were, I appreciate the fact that I had several mentors, I think, and not just mentors who were sort of self-serving mentors who wanted me to, you know, take over the administrative duties of the division, but could really give me candid advice about, looking at my interests in research and critical care, which, by the way, was sort of not really a thing when I finished cardiology 2014, 2013. And so I surround myself with a team of local mentors in Vancouver, but I have to say I had great mentors as well at Duke who basically said to me, you need to sort of ask for what you want, know your value as a trainee, because I think, you know, as an emerging young faculty, and I think that helped a lot with my early career transition. I mean, the other thing too is, I mean, I was very fortunate to have a very supportive spouse. She jokes, I mean, she's a chartered accountant, but she was there, we got married in medical school, so she's been, you know, every elective, you know, every application to fellowship. So, I mean, certainly surround, you know, if you can find a supportive partner, that's always very helpful as well for the early career transition. But I think getting, you know, having mentors and seeking out mentors, I think is very important, starting in fellowship.
Was the mentorship process for you during fellowship and in your first year or two as staff a formal one where your division head met with you and said you should meet so-and-so and they're going to be your mentor, or was it just kind of like an impromptu, informal thing?
So a bit of both. So some of it was organic. I mean, you gravitate towards like-minded people. You know, usually you meet them clinically during fellowship, so that's part of it. But I did create a structured mentorship program. So I have monthly calls with some of my mentors from Duke still, and we talk not specifically about any research project or anything, but we just talk about, you know, there's no plan. It's not scripted, but it is sort of in the calendar or quarterly calls. You know, we have a program at UBC where I am set up with a mentor as well, which is more formal. So. But I think that you need to do that. I think it's important to sort of formalize that mentorship process early on. And it's not, the discussions are not around a specific topic or project. It's just, let's take half an hour and have a discussion about whatever. And then I think then you can ask questions, talk about challenges, and you have that protected time.
So I have the sense that that might be pretty unique. For people in the room, how many when they started their career had a formal mentor that worked with them to help them transition? Raise your hand. Okay, so we have one person. For those of you on the panel, so for John, Kathy, Chris, in your division of cardiology, is there a formal mentoring program for new faculty?
There's not at Dal, as you know, a formal, is this on?
Well, I know, but I'm trying to involve you know.
There's not a formal mentor program at Dalhousie, but I would say the vast majority of people do self-select mentors, and certainly when I was division head, I would recommend that, and if people didn't know who to choose, I would give them some suggestions. The things that I found worked the best for what I saw and for myself, it's not necessarily just one mentor, and then I think that's partially why formal mentorship programs fail. It's either not a good match or the mentor can only mentor in a certain area. So for myself, I had, you know, sort of my work-life balance person I would go to when I was melting down because I couldn't balance work and life. I had a different person to go to talk to about research needs, and a different person to go to talk about you know, clinical needs and what was sadly lacking when I was young was another woman to talk to about some of the more unique challenges that we had. So that's much better now with a lot more women on faculty, certainly at our center, but that's what I think a lot of programs are.
Yeah, and I should mention that, you know, there are multiple mentors, so, you know, it's not the same person. Mm-hmm. And they're at various institutions.
Mm-hmm. Now, as Kathy alluded to, there's some unique mentoring that needs to happen with female cardiologists, and we have a Women in Cardiology Night event at our Dalhousie, where this year we're going to Sharon Mulvey's Vineyard or somewhere. That sounds like fun. And that's where we talk about a lot of those things. I have a sense that sort of mentorship would be useful for male cardiologists with young families too. Did you find that you got any kind of mentorship around how to balance your family life with your job from any of your mentors? And is that something that should happen?
No, I had mentorship in that sense too. I had mentors who emphasized, you know, they had just gone through this maybe 10 years before, so we definitely had those discussions, yeah.
Yeah, and that's great. I mean, you know, one of the things about being early career that you know, we talked about this a little bit on our planning call. There's this little bit of a paradox when you're first starting out your career, you know, maybe even during your residency, during your fellowship, you're extremely busy. I mean, not to say that late career cardiologists aren't busy, but it's a time of kind of, you're really having to put a lot of energy into, you know, starting that research program, doing that fellowship training, doing all this extra call, and you're really trying to establish yourself. And so it's a really heavy, busy time of your career. And just so happens that it lines up for a lot of people with a really busy, heavy time in life too, with having small children and all that that entails. And so we'll talk about that when we talk about work-life balance, but we may as well just get your take on that right now, Chris. Is that something that you think you've succeeded at? What are your tricks and tips for other people that are trying to launch a career with young families?
It's interesting. I had this conversation last night. I mean, I'm always working to be better with balance. I had a lot of warning that coming back and doing research and the clinical burden. So I was forewarned that it would be challenging. My only tips are, I mean, you have to be organized, and you look at your week, and you have meetings scheduled and clinics scheduled and CCU or whatever, but you also, you need to schedule in the other stuff. So I have my kids' activities in my calendar. My assistant has access. I have date night with my spouse in there, and we're lucky we have some family support. But even if you didn't, I think you need to be, because you know, you need to be very deliberate. So I guess you know, you're very deliberate with your clinical stuff, your research stuff, but I think you need to be deliberate with the other parts of your life.
One of the big stresses for trainees, I think, is even just the notion of, will I be able to find a job? So I think that's something I've been as program director for 7 years. I often heard that from my trainees, that there's this sense that there's no jobs. There's this idea that you need to do 3 or 4 or 5 fellowships to super duper train yourself to get your dream job. And that the sort of getting a job piece kind of ties in with the retirement piece. So we'll talk about that for a minute, just to kind of transition our way into that, because the two are linked. So my next question for you guys, if you can get your devices out, is just to get a sense of who would continue to work if they won $1 million in Lotto Max and who wouldn't. So here's the options. How do I get the up? Do I just have to again to get the options? Yeah, here we are. You win $50 million in Lotto Max. Do you retire now? Do you continue to work full-time, or do you transition to part-time work? It's for everybody in the audience. Keeping in mind, we might be a special elected audience of cardiovascular specialists, because the ones that would want to retire right now may not have even come to this conference. You know what I mean? Well, so that's interesting. So 20 of us, that's so more than 59% of us have said we would transition to part-time work. I must say I'm in that group too. 20% of us say we'd continue to work full-time, and only 22% say that they'd retire now. So I think that's a pretty interesting statistic. And if it shows that as people in this room, at least, we are passionate enough about what we do that we want to keep doing it for the most part. And here's another question. So at what age do you want to retire? It's not hard to predict for some people, but just ballpark, what age do you want to be when you retire? So we'll go to that. Just wait till the options come up. So don't type in an answer. Okay, so 50 to 59, 60 to 64, 65 to 70, greater than 70. So type in 1 for the first one, 2 for the second one, 3. And then the last option is till death do us part, for those of you that never want to retire. Anybody? Oh my goodness, 6% in that category. That's surprising. So 30% want to retire early. 37% want to do 60 to 64. 20% in kind of the traditional 65 range, 3% greater than 70, and 6% want to just keep working as long as they possibly can. That's interesting. So the retirement's sort of a hot topic. So I sent around an email to the division heads of cardiology. It went to the division heads of cardiology, cardiac surgery, and pediatric cardiology, actually. And I got responses from 8 of the division heads. I didn't keep sending them reminder emails to harass them, so I probably could have got higher responses, but I just was looking for a kind of a snapshot. So how many cardiologists have retired from your division in the past 5 years? So it really was not very many. So in our division, it was 3. Most divisions had 0 to 5, and even big divisions. The highest was 5. In one of the Toronto divisions reported 5 people retired in the past 5 years. So that's not many when you consider how many new trainees are being trained and being graduated every year. You would sort of expect more than one cardiologist to retire per year. There are lots of reports of the older cardiologists going from full-time to part-time work. The second question was, how many cardiologists over the age of 65 are still practicing full or part-time? And the lowest range that I got on that for an answer to that question was 10%, and the highest was 24%. So you get the sense there's a lot of cardiologists still practicing over the age of 65, at least amongst the 8 division heads that answered my poll. Do you think that resistance to retire has been a barrier to hiring in your division? Most of the 8 said yes. I think 5 of 8 said yes, and 3 said no. And there was even one response that said, no, actually, it's helpful to have senior division members staying on and taking a reduction in FTE and helping out with the things that need helping out with. But in some provinces, and specifically Quebec, the positions are tied to the cardiologist. So even if you wanted to be a 0.2 cardiologist, it doesn't release all of a sudden a 0.8 for somebody else. So some provinces have very strict rules around how many licenses can be issued for a given specialty. And so some people that responded to my survey were very vehement that this was a big problem in their division. So go backwards. So we're going to talk about retirement now and transition to retirement. A few of you on the panel have been division heads for cardiology. John, I guess we'll start with you since you're the person to whom this topic was assigned. What do you think the barriers are around retirement? What are the challenges you faced as a division head with retiring colleagues?
Complicated question. I think that as you've just shown, there are many variables. I'm actually surprised only to see most people over 60, you know, that many people retired 65. That's certainly not true in downtown Toronto. They're probably still paying for their house or stuck in traffic. Around the year 2000 in Ontario, it wasn't really a matter of licensing, but most procedures, particularly cath lab-based DP procedures, began to capitate. I mean, the province actually did a good job in increasing service provision, but they still controlled the number of procedures. And so, actually, particularly for academic teaching hospitals, you no longer had the opportunity to recruit into increasing volumes. So it has created a challenge to expand the number of young people you recruit as people work into their mid-70s. And I think that continues to be a substantial problem for most medical leaders, because it's not that they would like to remove their highly experienced, thoughtful people in their late 60s, but they actually would like to bring new energy into their divisions. From a personal perspective, I mean, individual perspective, one of the things I noted is I had, as division head, I had sort of two people that were in their mid-60s, or two groups of people. The people that were very pleasant and happy to deal with, pleasant on my part, were the people who came in with a landing plan. You know, they would actually say, well, I'd like to do this and this, and I plan to retire around here. And then there were others that were, you know, work until I drop, which made planning very difficult. But I actually see it as a big challenge for certainly I think all medical centers, but most of the non-academic cardiac centers in Ontario, relatively new, like in the last 15 years, and certainly for the academic medical setting, it's a big challenge going forward, because They really don't have the increase in Ministry of Health billings to support recruitment as people work into their mid-70s.
Another thing that comes up is sometimes people in their, when they get into their late 60s and 70s, and maybe earlier in interventional cardiology, feel that call is something that they're no longer willing, able, I don't know what the right word is, but to do. And so trying to find a role for somebody that doesn't participate in the call schedule is sometimes challenging and may kind of overburden the new recruits with their more than their sort of fair share of call per FTE, and those are the people that have the young children and whatnot. So have you dealt with that in your division with people that didn't want to do call anymore?
Not formally. Actually, I heard several years ago, or more than 15 years ago, one of the community hospitals, North York General Hospital, that their Department of Medicine had a formula. So if you're over 65 and you'd served for more than 30 years, it was a deal that you didn't have to do call. Some people chose to. And I actually think a formulation like that is quite reasonable. My personal view is that it's probably not unreasonable for people to not take call after a certain point, but I think everybody in the group has to agree to it. Certainly in our center, we don't have a formula, and actually, it hasn't been an issue in most cases. There are one or two cases I can think of where some senior individuals felt they didn't want to do call anymore, and there was not a lot of rife about it, but it didn't really penetrate down in terms of numbers, in terms of the number asking for that it had a great impact on people.
Kathy and Chris, I'm sure you guys both dealt with that and in your 10 years as division heads.
Yeah, and in my role as a vice dean, I've had an opportunity to see a lot of other kinds of docs and nurses and rehab specialists that come to retirement, and it's been my experience that very few like to plan for it. And I think for a lot of us, our identities are so wrapped up in our professional personas that it's something we tend to sort of put off. And it creates a great barrier for recruitment because we haven't been creative enough to imagine a transition that might bring in a new person who job shares for a couple of years, and you can get the mentorship and the benefit of the wisdom and kind of give that ease out kind of plan for the outgoing person. But the best story I can think of is attending a retirement party for a colleague who was not in cardiology, and it had all of the usual, you know, accolades and laughs and tears and everything. And then at the end, he came to me as the session was wrapping up. And, you know, this really tough surgical personality kind of guy who was always the go-to guy for 40 years, you know, tears in his eyes. And I'll just refer to him as Dr. X. But he said, Chris, what am I going to do? Who am I if I'm not Dr. X? And we haven't done a very good job, I think, in sort of imagining and planning for retirements in a creative and respectful way.
Kathy, anything to add on that?
I think Chris really hit the nail on the head. It has been my experience in my leadership positions, the very same thing, that the vast majority of physicians who have chosen medicine as their career think of it as a calling, and it is their personality. And that would be true for me. I've been a doctor since I was 23. I don't have another personality. I mean, that's just who I am. And I do have some hobbies, but planning for retirement is, it's almost inconceivable to think of what you would do with your days. And yet, it's a huge obstacle to recruitment. And part of the problem is just plain old-fashioned money. I think most medical leaders understand that they should be transitioning older physicians out and bringing new physicians and surgeons in with a crossover period and a mentorship period. What wonderful way to mentor young people. And our funding mechanisms, whether they be fee-for-service or alternative funding plans, our hospital hierarchy, our university hierarchy, does not allow us to duplicate jobs. And so the leaders are, their hands are tied. And so I think in order to do it better, we need to help physicians who are looking at retirement. I mean, where is the funding to send an old interventionalist like me off to do 6 months of echo training so that I could transition to a job that was office-based in the community that might really help the wait lists and the colleagues? I mean, no one has that funding. There's so many things you could do, but you have to reinvent yourself, and there's no support for that. And I think at a larger level, and I see back there in the audience trying to be ignored, Gigi Osler, the going president of CMA, it's not just cardiovascular medicine, it's all of medicine. There's a huge balloon of baby boomer physicians and surgeons, all of whom are looking to reinvent themselves in a way that they can still be productive, still use the skills that they have because, you know, they want to help people. That is who we are. And yet transition young people in. And so there needs to be mechanisms to let people retrain in a different medical area or retrain in a non-medical area. Like, you know, maybe I could go back and, you know, learn to play music better and not just be an average kitchen guitar player. I mean, but there's no mechanism or support for that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's interesting. I do think we do a poor job of that. Like, you almost need a mentorship for your retirement. And, you know, my husband, as I mentioned, he's a retired Navy officer, and the federal government will pay up to $80,000 for those guys to retrain in something. He can use it to do whatever kind of university degree or college degree he wants. Obviously, no one's going to give us that kind of money. And I mean, the money is a important thing that some people don't realize, that for the nurses in the audience, physicians don't have pensions. And so I was talking to one of my colleagues, an interventional cardiologist, earlier this week, and he was telling me about one of his sons in medical school and his daughter's doing really well, and she wants to go into politics and this and that. And he has, I think, 6 kids. And he was saying, so basically, I'm never going to retire. And then he added, well, actually, I've bought a row of townhouses, so maybe I can use that as my retirement income. And isn't it ironic that here we are, we're well-paid specialists, but we still have stress about being able to afford to retire, which I think a lot of people don't appreciate. So that's another factor. Now, I want to talk to Sue, because I feel like nurses do a better job of retiring than doctors. I find the nurses retire, they're pretty happy. If they choose to come back and work casual, they do, but they don't have to. And it just seems to be a more cheery kind of thing when nurses retire. What are the struggles around nursing retirements? What sort of drives people to want to retire or to stay working? What do you think the issues are there?
Well, I think the biggest struggle we have right now is I work in a province that has a 56% of our nurses have the ability to retire within the next 5 years. And so we have a significant nursing shortage. I think we can thank the Canadian economy for keeping nurses in nursing. That's a sad statistic. But I do think nurses do a really good job of retiring. But I think nurses, because we are a female-dominated population, I think women actually do a better job of finding hobbies, of volunteer work, of being the grandmother. And then there is significant joy, from what I hear from my colleagues, to come back because you don't have to be there. And there's a big, you know, probably the nurses who are in their middle of their career kind of look forward and say, oh my God, I have to work with Nellie, who's 69 years old. But Nellie has a lot to offer her patients. And so she may not be the best at managing the pulmonary artery catheter, but she certainly is really good at managing. So when you go home, who are you going to live with? What kind of stairs do you have to do? So the soft skills of nursing get better as you get older, and I think that's because you put real life into perspective.
So I guess question for the audience. We all know people who are retired. You know, what do you think makes a good retirement? What are the factors that make a retirement easier, happier? What is it we should be teaching people about how to occupy themselves or how to make retirement something they want? Does anybody want to add what they think is useful for retirement? So you have to be able to afford to retire. Yes, that's good.
I mean, it's $1,500 a month. So if you don't have anything else coming in behind your savings, or a spouse or a partner that is able to help you, I've been doing that for the last 3-4 years. I've pensioned. I have not retired, so I am taking my pension.
So you know, part of it for, I meet with my financial planner, whatever it is, once a year, and there's always this chart of, like, you know, that goes up to when I'm, you know, 95, and, you know, the money goes up, and then it starts to dwindle on my projected whatever, and then, like, oh, well, I better not live past 96, because it looks like I'm not going to have any money left. So there's this business of, for those that don't have, like, a kind of fixed pension that is going to carry on, how long is that money going to last, and how long do I want to live?
I attended the OMA retirement seminar a few years ago, and I thought it was extremely helpful and well done. They pointed out in broad strokes that the two pieces in your retirement are time and money, and gathering up the money is up to you, and managing your time is the big problem. So it was actually very structured and helpful, and if you can attend an OMA seminar, I think that would be a resource that would be useful in planning retirement.
Yes. Getting my exercise now.
Yeah. Sorry. I'm not in your retirement, but I'm with this cohort of people around me who are retiring. And what I hear a lot from them is their frustration with the system. So they're done, or they felt like they haven't been able to keep up, or they don't have enough to give, or if I stay, I have to keep doing, you know, this extra training or other things. And so even in my sort of management world, in the cardiology program, that's what we hear a lot of, is I'm going to have to keep doing this, I'm going to have to keep doing that, and it's not worth it, and we're not gaining any ground. They're frustrated, and they're ready to go enjoy life rather than fighting all the time. So I'm interested to hear sort of from the physician perspective, is that a similar approach to that factor? If I don't feel like I'm contributing anymore, or I don't have the same to give, or is that what continues the drive, is that there's always another patient to take care of?
John, do you want to tackle the answer to that one?
I think it's actually, I think it depends on your circumstance. Certainly when I'm seeing my clinical practice, I feel like I'm contributing. Interesting, after more than 30 years of practice, I think my learning curve is as steep or steeper than it was when I began. But when I look at myself within the institution, I actually commonly now feel I don't really contribute much anymore. And I think that's probably, to some extent, fairly institution-specific and a little bit your own person-specific, but it is quite easy, certainly within the academic health center model, to feel like you're not significant anymore when you have, particularly if you had a fairly high administrative role, and then you succumb to that, or you transition from that. I have to say that from a clinical perspective and a patient care perspective, I think I actually feel now more involved and more relevant than I did when I had a higher administrative role, because I actually put more blood, sweat, and tears into it. And before, I used to excuse myself from doing that because I felt I had more important things to do, which was probably not the case. I think a general comment, and I speak about, I guess, about the medical profession in the sense of physicians rather than nursing profession, but it probably goes both ways. About a quarter century ago, when I was first a new staff, David Waters, who is now in California but was a previous head of the Montreal Heart Institute, came looking at the job of the university head of the Division of Cardiology in Toronto, and he had recently moved to Connecticut. And as a young person, naively, I thought, you know, what on earth is this spectacularly successful guy who wrote New England Journal papers on the metro literally on his way. You know, he was just incredibly well published. He said, "What are you doing in Connecticut?" And his answer to me is something I've never forgotten. He said, "I made a decision in my own life to not do the same thing for more than 10 years." And actually, he's followed that commitment pretty well, because he went to Connecticut, and maybe not even 10 years later, he went to California, where he's at UCSF. And when I look across the board, it's not uniform, but certainly for the medical profession, most people land in their healthcare center, and they stay there forever. And I think that's a bit Canadian. I trained for 5 years in Boston, and it was like watching a game of checkers. People move so quickly, some of which I think is for the wrong reason. But I've followed the model, right? I've been in Toronto for now nearly 28 years. But it is something that I've thought about many times, that I think people get stuck in their roles. And for some people, that's a superb place to be. It all works. The stars align, family's happy, job is good, patients are happy, academics in terms of research or administration, teaching is going well. But I think a lot of people actually, probably a minority thankfully, actually the stars don't align, but they actually don't actually, for some reason, say, okay, it's now time to move. That's something I've not done, and I think I've had good reason to do so and not followed it for a whole host of reasons. At some point around the year 2000, I looked at a job in Vancouver to become chief of cardiology before I became chief of cardiology in Toronto, and my older daughter was then 9 years old, and we were discussing my recent look at the job in Vancouver, and Larissa was sort of not paying complete attention, and then she looked up from her homework and said, "Are you going to take a job in Vancouver?" And I said, "Well, I might." And her answer was very clear. "Well, have a good time."
Yeah, it's interesting. these are important, of course, discussions to have. I think a lot of people, you know, they're comfortable where they are, as you say. It takes a lot of bravery to get up and move a whole new place and learn a whole new system and maybe pick up your kids and move somewhere else. Kathy, I'm sure you had plenty of opportunity to move over the years with other job prospects, but why would you want to? You got a nice house in Bedford and your husband's got a job there. Like, sometimes it's just difficult to do that. And then, you know, it's the same thing. We're so used to being cardiologists, and again, your identity is kind of all wrapped up in that. It's scary to think of giving that up. What am I going to do next? In preparation for this, I talked to a colleague of mine who recently retired, and I asked him sort of what went well, what were the challenges, what did he miss, and he said he was very lucky to have been given the opportunity to, rather than just going from full-time to being retired, to being able to kind of knock back his FTE and work point, I think it was 0.9 and then 0.8. At some point he didn't do call or weekends anymore. He was in his 70s when he did retire. And he said that was very useful. So, you know, rather than just abruptly, and then all of a sudden when he was 50%, he had like a month on and a month off just to kind of ease himself into being retired. He said that he kept himself busy once he was retired by taking a course in oil painting. So he did some oil painting, and then he learned to play the piano at the age of 73. So he's sort of taken up some hobbies, and he and his wife are doing some traveling. The thing that he misses the most, he says, are the patients. So, you know, to speak to what Dr. Parker was saying earlier, even if you've given up administrative and teaching roles, you always have that connection with your patients, and there's always going to be more patients to see. So it's not like there's a lack of work. There's always work to do. So I thought that was interesting. Does anybody else have any comments before we move on to talking about burnout? Okay. Burnout. Yay. So Dr. Simpson and Dr. Morris, you may as well be a doctor. Mrs. Morris, sort of were assigned this topic, but as you know, it's just a panel discussion. We're all talking about it. There is just a couple slides on this. So this was from 2019, just earlier this year. There was a survey of, this is American data, but of U.S. cardiologists, 27 American cardiologists are burnt out, and half, so 49.5%. are under stress. So that was a survey that was published in JACC. And on the nursing end, this is Canadian data from 2016 out of Edmonton, moral distress and burnout amongst healthcare providers in a cardiovascular intensive care. And in this particular study, they found that the moral distress and burnout were common across interprofessional providers, but most prevalent actually among nurses and RRTs. In that particular one, five themes emerged as contributing factors: care of complex patients, team communication, provision of non-beneficial therapy, I think we all have some stress around that, end of life care and strained capacity. Chris, I guess we'll start with you. As former CMA president, you must have done some work in this area of physician burnout as well. What is your sense of what we're doing well and what we're doing poorly as cardiovascular scientists in dealing with burnout?
Well, I think it's fair to say there's increasing recognition that this is an important problem, something we need to tackle, not just because it's the right thing to do, but also because it needs to be a strategic priority. You know, if you look at healthcare professionals who get themselves in trouble with the college or with disciplinary processes, it's almost always connected to burnout, you know, and the moral distress that kind of is involved with that. So those of you who are in roles where you've had to participate in a discipline escalation process, you know what a soul-sucking exercise this is. I was speaking with somebody yesterday who was a leader in dealing with this, and so it's certainly something that I think we need to deal with as organizations from a strategic perspective. The really interesting thing about burnout in medicine, I think, is that when you look at some of the data, and in particular the physician health survey that is done virtually every year, it's kind of a uniform thing across all disciplines. You know, the different contributors to burnout or the characteristics of a burned out health professional are shared in the surgical and the medical disciplines. It's in family medicine. The only group of docs that seem to be relatively protected are the ones that have prominent administrative roles, interestingly. And I don't know whether that's because have developed better skills in coping, or for me personally, what I think it is that it's allowed me to continue a clinical role, and the clinical role becomes my refuge instead of the relentless day after day burnout inducing experience that it is for people who work really hard clinically. So for me, my peaceful days are when I'm in the EP lab doing something I've done a million times before. I know I'm really good at it. There's nobody else in my ear, and my blood pressure is 90 over 60, and it feels great. But when I'm in my administrative office, I feel tense all day. I take it home with me and so on. So even though that didn't resonate with me, I think I can understand why. It's because clinical medicine, as I think you suggested earlier, is my refuge. Whereas I think for a lot of people who do a heavy burden of clinical work, it's the opposite. It becomes just this relentless push of more and more and more, and the resources are dwindling and dwindling and dwindling. So the only other observation I would make is that I think while it's really important for healthcare professions to have this discussion and to start to develop strategic approaches and culture change, which is also sorely needed, we have to be really careful in the way that this is messaged to the public, because I will tell you that when we talk about us feeling bad and sad and burnt out, the public does not give a crap, right? We are a privileged group of professionals, we're paid very well, and we're not going to get any public sympathy. The strategy can't be to try to engender public sympathy. This is an internal question and problem for us to solve.
Dr. Parker was going to make a comment, and then Sue will swing it over to you.
I want to echo what Dr. Simpson just said, and with a slightly different view that one of the things that I think that burnout is a major problem for healthcare professionals. And the stress of being a physician on all sides is much more than it was when I started, like in logarithmic terms, and I'm sure that's true of the nursing profession. But I also think this relates to saying, you know, we are hard done by. I think we actually have to recognize that everyone in the system, all of the support staff, everyone from the first responders to the clerks on a ward desk, the administrators in hospitals, the accountants, everyone is suffering their own different version of this. And many of the outcomes of having more stress is good. The healthcare quality is better, the administrative quality is better, but it is, I think, across the whole healthcare system, something that we need to recognize and not individualize. I think actually the medical profession, possibly to some extent, is doing a little bit of a whoa, it's only me story. It's really not only us, it's everyone in the system. And it's a self-exaggerating phenomenon. I mean, if you deal with a burnt-out assistant, if you deal with a burnt-out ward clerk, if you deal with a burnt-out anyone in the healthcare system, of course it doesn't work well, and that makes the problem worse. I used to say I like people to come to me with problems that they have a solution for. I have no solution, but it is something that across the board we need to recognize, because we are sort of feeding on our own individual burnouts, and they're making it worse.
Sue, did you want to say something about burnout amongst nursing professionals?
So burnout is probably one of the biggest issues that nurses are facing. And I think many of us are blaming it on the nursing shortage. I think it's a very multifactorial problem. But it's difficult when you are a professional, but you also work under a union environment. And so some people would comment that being in a union impacts the integrity of your professionalism. That's up for debate. But when you look at nursing burnout, there's kind of two sides. It's burnout at work, and that's more of a compassion fatigue. And then there is trying to balance life, because many households, and I'm happy to say it's changing, but many households for women of my age, often you were the mother, possibly the breadwinner if you're in a single family. You go to work, you deal with the stress of work all day, and trying to balance that to at 3:30 in the afternoon or 11:30 in the evening to shut that off, come home, oh my God, I got four lunches to pack. I need to do this and this and this, and oh, I forgot to pay the hydro bill. And so it just becomes very overwhelming. Personally, I worked in ICU for the first 20 years of my career. Loved critical care. Until the one day I knew I was struggling and I knew I had compassion fatigue. So it's 3:28, and as a charge nurse, you never get off on time. It's 3:28, I've given report, everybody's stable, and I'm trying to grab my bag, say goodbye. It's a Friday afternoon, Friday night is date night in my house, and I hear, oh shit, and I turn
Beep.
Around. And so this happens, this is what happens in real life, and we are opening a chest. And so I threw my bag down, and my first thought was, frick, another date night I'm gonna miss. And so we do all the things that you're supposed to do when you open a chest and get the patient back to the OR. And it's about 6:45. I haven't bothered to call my husband because I don't have time to do that. And when I come through the door, I have tears in my eyes. And my husband says, it's okay, dear. You can miss date night. It's all right. I said, no, I'm crying, because all the way home, I'm thinking, somebody's life was sitting here. And my first thought was, you're missing date night? That patient survived, did well. But that was a point in my career when I decided, I think I need to leave critical care. And I'm a much better educator now because of that. Yeah.
I do want to have some audience participation questions, so get out your phones again. This is a personal question, but do you suffer from burnout? And there's a scale here that you can look at. I don't know if that's going to come up automatically for me. Never. My job is pretty chill. Some days are better than others. I'd say sometimes, probably around half the time. And then the last option is I feel burnt out more often than not in my workplace. So it looks like most people, all but 14%, really are suffering from some extent of burnout. I guess that makes sense because we deal with super sad cases and super tough situations. So I think invariably you're going to feel burnt out at least some of the time, but that's interesting to see. And the other thing is a narrative. So what are the factors that you think contribute to burnout? So for this, you just type in a word into your phone and it'll come up in some kind of a cloud or something. Apparently.
So while you're typing, I just wanted to, for the nurses in the audience, I wanted to let you know that the Canadian Council of Cardiovascular Nurses has a mentoring program. We are always looking for mentors and mentees. Try and match people, and it can be across the country. It doesn't need to be in your workplace. And it's been very successful. We've had a couple of mentor mentees present at national conferences about their relationship, and it's very successful.
So there's a lot of different words up there. So work, workload, time, many overwhelming patients, personal roles, leadership, bullying. Bullying's an issue in the workplace for a lot of people. Autonomy, compassion. So, I mean, that's an interesting thing to have a look at. I think for me, personally, there was something that happens when you go from being a trainee to being a staff person, and maybe, Chris, you could speak to this because you're more recent than I am, but when you're a resident, there's always this feeling that there's somebody that you can talk to. Like, there's the resident affairs office, or there's some kind of resources to you. But then it seems to me when you start on staff that maybe there are resources, but nobody's informing you of what they are. And there's this kind of sense that kind of now you're on your own, you don't get post-call days, and nobody really is checking in to make sure you're okay. I don't know if we need to do a better job of kind of looking after early staff people, because I think if you're going to get burnt out, that would be the time. Certainly in my career arc so far, the most stressful time was in my early career.
You know, that's a good point. I think it's important, though, even as a staff, I mean, to foster a culture of being able to ask questions, because it turns out that even after you've trained for 8 years or more, you still don't know the answers, and there's it's very different. I find actually the outpatient clinic is actually where I had most of my questions, because we don't do as much of that during our training, and then all of a sudden you're out on your own. But I think I'm fortunate. I have a reasonably supportive division, and we ask each other's questions all the time. Some of my mentors will come into my office and say, well, what would you do in this situation as well? So I think finding one or two people that you can really just bounce ideas off of, and I think is really important. The stress, I think, for me has always been, and what you were alluding to is, not having control of time in your life, and that's the challenging part in training. Is it's better, I think, as a staff. But when you have the situation where you're trying to leave the hospital, and you know it's out of your control, and you're missing things. I mean, I think most of us, and maybe you know, I'd be happy to hear what everyone else has to say, but don't mind working hard when we need to be there, right? It's just when you lose control of that. And other parts of your life were affected. That's hard.
Yeah, and I mean, somebody alluded to the home responsibilities. I think increasingly, you know, your generation of people, the men would have a lot more home responsibility than sort of an older generation. My colleague I just alluded to, who retired when I started on staff as a new staff, he and I shared a secretary, and I mean, he was in his probably his early 60s when I started on staff. He didn't retire till he was in his early 70s. And I can remember him telling me, oh, well, now that you're here, Sarah, I imagine you'll want to buy the Secretary Day gift for our secretary. Well, it used to be my wife that would do that, but you'll want to do it now, won't you? And I'm like, really? Can we not still just get your wife to do that? Like, you know. So, and I mean, he had this situation where he had to do nothing, right? He came to work and then he went home. There was no little kids to look after, and he didn't do any cooking or cleaning or anything like that. And I'm now living that life because my husband's retired. So for me, I had this big transition before he retired and then after he retired, where now I live that life. I get up in the morning, I say goodbye to my family, kiss everybody, and then my husband has to survive the reality of getting them dressed and into the school/daycare. He picks them up. He usually has dinner ready for me. It's awesome. To any of you who can swing having a retired husband, go for it. It's great. But, you know, contrast that with my one of my female colleagues who's married to a surgeon. You know, I was in the echo lab with her one day, and she had her computer open, and she was doing something that looked important. I'm like, what's going on? She said, well, today's the day you have to sign your kids up for the programs, the soccer and the... and whatnot. I'm like, oh my God, did I know that? I called my husband. He's like, nobody told me that. I'm like, damn it. But this is the information that, you know, women for the most part look after in the family. They look after signing the kids up for camps and that sort of thing. And my husband wants to do it, but none of the women's groups will take him in and tell him. So I still have to get that information from my female colleague and forward feed it to him, much to his chagrin. He would like to be responsible for all those things. So the stresses at home really do contribute to the burnout, I think, for a lot of men and women. And that really brings us to the time management piece, which I think Kathy is really the guru of time management, having managed to have three children and one while she was a program director and juggled all these leadership roles and being an interventional cardiologist along the way. So why don't we, and we're still talking about burnout along with time management, so if anybody has anything to say, just shout and I'll bring you the microphone over. Kathy?
So I think everyone in this room has heard about imposter syndrome, which I've suffered from the first time I got my letter accepting me to medical school. I went through 4 years of medicine thinking they were going to take away my yellow Dalhousie medical student sign as soon as they figured out they made the mistake. And I get asked to... I have mine too. I get asked to give talks on work-life balance and time management a lot. And I always feel like the true imposter because... true to my Irish Catholic heritage, I just feel guilty about everything. So what my section should really be called Mistakes I Have Made, and maybe you all can learn from them. But, you know, they say it takes a village to raise a child. I think it takes more than a village. It takes a city and a country to support a cardiologist or cardiovascular surgeon. I can't speak to the nursing side of it. It's different. I can only speak to my experience. But time management is beyond critical. Like, I just can't stress enough how you need to know how to manage your time to be able to be successful in balancing a busy family life and work. But what you need is you need help. So you need if you have a partner, your partner has to be 100% on board and supportive. And in my house, my husband still was very traditional, and I still did all the female traditional roles. But you can't. So, and he wasn't going to change. So in our house, what worked is to hire out as much as you could. Forget about the money, it doesn't matter how much it costs. So whether it's a live-in housekeeper or a housekeeper that comes every day, or if it's a daycare center, or if it's a whatever, different solutions work for different families, different geography, different whatever. But the solution that worked for us was both Dave and I needed a wife, a traditional wife, so we hired a wife. So the wife showed up and she was a lovely housekeeper and she was with us for 20 years. She showed up every morning at 7 a.m. and she did everything that your classic 1950s wife would have done. And I paid her very well and I had three of everything. So if you need one car seat for your car and one for the husband's car, you had to have one for the housekeeper as well.
Jeannie, right?
Jeannie.
We all know Jeannie.
Yeah, Jeannie had... Everybody knew Jeannie. Jeannie unfortunately passed away of a brain tumor a couple of years ago, but like we call the robot vacuum in our house the genie. And she was an integral part of raising our family. But so was my secretary, my administrative assistant. Every single event for the whole family was a group planning event that went into my calendar, my secretary's calendar, and the big calendar on the fridge to try to ensure that I would, in advance, block off time for school plays and for graduations and grading day. You can't underestimate the importance of those things to 5 and 6 year olds. I found that out again the hard way when I missed the first concert in preschool, and my kid was there crying because she was the only one whose mom and dad didn't show up. So after that, everything went into the calendar, everything. And I would tell my assistant, it is just as important for me to have that afternoon off to go to a school play as if there's a cardiac arrest. And I didn't just block off. I watched my male colleagues. They have to go to a graduation at 4. They block themselves off from 3:45 onwards. And there's always a disaster 15 minutes before you're supposed to be somewhere. So I would block off the whole day. I would take a vacation day or block off at least half a day to try to avoid that last-minute disaster. I booked my vacations around things that the family had to do, and everything went into an electronic calendar that was shared with everyone. And I made sure the people that worked with me understood that this is the way my life works. If you don't like it, go ahead, fire me. I'll work somewhere else where this does work. And of course, in the end, you actually get respect for being organized. I never did less work than the others. I would swap it. So when I have clumped call so that I could get something special off. And you do your very best. And in the end, there's still gonna be a day where your teenage daughter's gonna say, I hate you because you were never around like the other mothers. And that happens, and it happens to every one of us. And it's really hard. I heard a couple people speak about date night. Date night is really super important. Since the day that our first child was born, a babysitter showed up every night at 6 o'clock on Thursdays. That was our date night. And now, 33 years later, still with the same partner, and we still know each other. So that works. Having time for personal stuff is really important in the work-life balance, but don't kid yourself. Those things are not stress-free. Like, weekends at the cottage and ski vacations with 3 little kids and 2 dogs, like, you know what, they were fun, but they were probably more stressful than my worst nights on call in the CCU because, you know, you still have to do all the work. And so I'd come back to work more exhausted than when I left. But they were fun. They were great memories. They're not without stress. So family stuff is really stressful.
Last weekend, my husband was in Vegas for the Dad's Married to Doctors Facebook group retreat. So I had my 2 toddlers, we had 2 hockey practices, we had a birthday party, we had soccer, we had ballet, and yeah, there was a bottle of wine involved in me coping with that, and TGIM, I'm going to work on Monday, woohoo, see you later. We don't have that much time left, but I did want to open it to the audience to see if anyone had any comments about burnout or time management or things they wanted to say or questions they wanted to ask our esteemed panel. Anybody have questions, comments? Okay, well, Dr. Parker's got a comment. I want to hear from you.
Actually, being an older person, I always kind of don't understand what time management means. I mean, I hear your comments very well, but I guess I'll say, though, you're at risk when you do time management of doing things the wrong way. And you can manage things into the point of exhaustion. So there's a certain point where you realize that actually you have to not manage certain things. And actually that's when I got married when I was 36, and I used to work when I was single until like 8 o'clock in the evening. I'd go to my, when I was in Boston, I'd go to my little I joined a fitness club, and I'd do exercise, and I'd have dinner at 10 p.m. I'd come to work like the rest of the group at 7:30 o'clock in the morning. And of course, as soon as I got married and our first child arrived, that schedule didn't work very well. So my solution was just to get up for 15 years at 4 in the morning and be in my office at 5. I did that for 15 years. And, I felt I was superhuman. But actually, biology catches up with you. So, I'm not sure if many people in the room are as foolish as I was, but at a certain point in life, you have to learn as healthcare professionals that there are certain things you can't do. At least that was late advice I gave to myself. And when I hear the term time management, I actually look at myself and say, well, I managed that, but it probably wasn't the best thing I did in my life.
Yeah, I'm often up at 4 in the morning, but it's just because my toddler's screaming and not because I'm going to work then. God forbid. Any other comments from the panel or from the audience? Well, I just really like to thank the panel for coming and telling us a little bit about the side of you that's not just your job. I think this is a really helpful and informative session, and I thank everybody for coming. We'll wrap it up there.